The NHS is in crisis. Twitter is full of Hunt must go. But is he the cause of the problem, or merely just a symptom? I've got Roiben with me again, or technically Robin's got me with her because I'm round at hers again. And yeah, we figured we wanted to talk a little bit about the situation the NHS is in at the moment. Because, you know, I hit on it a bit last April when I talked about the junior doctors' strikes. And, you know, since then, you know, there's been some strikes. The Red Cross has said that the NHS is in crisis. The government has said the NHS is not in crisis. A&E waiting times are pretty high at the moment, something we experienced just over a week ago.
Yeah.
Had to take Roiben to A&E. We were seen fairly, you know, fairly briskly, but probably helped by the fact that you didn't need an actual bed.
Yeah.
There were beds queued up in the corridor and, you know, all
one
that.
Of those sort of situations where you can sit someone on a chair and just say, wait there.
Yeah. So, you know, then we were just sitting in a little side room that didn't need a bed. So, you know, we were fine. But, you know, it was a long wait. And, you know, this was on the wee small hours of a Friday morning. So, yeah, you know, we've seen, you know, firsthand, you know, certainly the A&E side of things at the moment. But I think one of the problems that you get at the moment is a lot of the kind of the popular opinion, at least the stuff you hear mainly from those who are sort of mainly anti-politics, is a slightly simplified look at things. You know, there's a lot of Jeremy Hunt must go. And, you know, as I said at the header, he's part of the problem, but is it that he's the root cause, or is it just he's symptomatic of the greater problem? And I, you know, my thinking is that it's like, you know, if you got rid of Jeremy Hunt and got someone else in charge of the NHS, with the current government, it would still be someone towing the current government's line.
Yeah.
And even with a different government, you'd still be going on, you know, what the funding is. The first thing I think that needs to be sorted really is the funding.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's underfunded. You can remove Jeremy Hunt and replace him with someone 10 times better, but if the funding's still crap, their hands are still tied. But even if you kept Jeremy Hunt in place, but if the NHS was funded better, things would still get better, because part of the problem is the funding.
Yeah. I mean, the government has said that they will put more money into the NHS. They have announced that recently over the news. But that money comes from somewhere else within the healthcare budget. So some other section, such as the social care, for example, which is also in crisis and underfunded, will have money taken away from it and put into the NHS, because that money has to come from somewhere. And they've already said, yes, that money will come from somewhere else within that pocket budget.
And in a way, it's the whole healthcare pocket that needs feeding.
Mm.
You know, I think. I mean, let me get my thoughts straight. I mean, part of the problem that I think you get at the moment is, I mean, okay, as I said in last year's vlog, Jeremy Hunt's plans were unpopular, not so much because of what they were, but because they were trying to do things without extra money. The plans, or the ideas, weren't at fault. It's the funding that's the problem. But I personally think some of the ideas were good. I mean, at the moment, the idea of the, you know, them wanting to be a 7-day NHS is getting an awful lot of public backlash. But again, although they're saying that yes, it's because, you know, you're trying to do 7-day NHS on the same budget, a lot of people seem to be annoyed about the idea itself, not the lack of funds. And the problem is that the ideas are good. It's going to be difficult to get public backing if you've got people trying to say, no, you shouldn't do this because that idea sucks. And you've got someone like me who kind of goes, actually, although I appreciate that they need more money to do it, a 7-day NHS would be really, really good. And that if more people were able to see GPs at more times, it would potentially alleviate some of the pressures on A&E. I'm not saying that the way they're wanting to do it is good, but by saying that the idea sucks, well, I don't buy that either.
No, I think the problem isn't so much what the idea is, it's how they're looking to carry it out. They're looking to carry it out on an NHS that's majorly underfunded, and what they're basically saying is, well, doctors on the current pay should continue on the current pay, but do extra hours. And we don't have the infrastructure for that. We don't actually have enough doctors. So you would have to train new doctors in order to work those extra hours. Because otherwise there's no shift cover.
But again, it all comes down to funding, because if I remember correctly, I think at least some of the problems from, you know, last year's strikes were because, you know, they were wanting to change some of the out of hours cover, you know, some of the evening and weekend cover. You know, it's like saying, you know, these are normal working hours, and, you know, the junior doctors were saying, no, these are not normal working hours. The problem is, it's actually somewhere between the two, in a way, because, okay, yes, if you're trying to, as a medical professional, have any sort of a life, some times of the day are going to be normal working hours, and some times of the day are going to screw with your personal life. If, however, you're not a medical professional but are seeking medical help because, you know, whether it's, you know, heart attack, stroke, broken leg whilst playing sports, overdose, oh crap, something's wrong with my baby, whatever, that doesn't give a damn about office hours at all. If it's 3 o'clock on a Sunday morning, you go to A&E at 3 o'clock on a Sunday morning. But if there are less people staffing A&E, or, you know, certainly less junior doctors, or more junior doctors because there are less consultants, whatever it is, if there are less people staffing A&E because it's the wee small hours of a weekend rather than standard office times, yes, it's a bugger for whoever's working that shift. But that doesn't change the fact that it's potentially a lifesaver for whoever's been brought in at death's door. And that's the problem, that illness, injury, impulsive behaviour, alcohol-related stuff, if someone does something dumb because they're drunk, that's more likely to be out of hours than it is likely to be during office hours.
Basically, emergencies don't wait for office hours. They happen at any time given. And, you know, they're going to happen regardless of whether or not the consultants are in and working and, you know, willing to accept them into the A&E or the GP surgeries.
Or sometimes, emergencies, if they're discovered by someone else, might not be discovered until after office hours. Like I said, I needed to bring Robin to A&E. I'm staying with her for a little bit at the moment. But I was at work. Robin was not at work. I got home at about 6:30 in the evening, saw that Robin needed medical attention. If I'd not been at work, I could have taken her earlier in the day. I got back at 6:30 because I have a job. I mean, so did Robin, but Robin was off that day. But you know, that's the thing. The requirement for A&E does not respect office hours. But the other thing is, I think there are some things that if they can be seen by a regular GP outside, you know, further outside of regular office hours, some things are less likely to escalate to the point where they're going to need an out-of-hours A&E visit, potentially. I mean, you were saying the other day when we were chatting about this, your GP surgery does 8 till 8 Monday to Friday, is it?
Yes. My GP surgery is open 8 till 8 on Monday to Friday. I'm not sure what the weekend hours are. They are also quite long. But 8 in the morning until 8 p.m. And there's always the GP and the nurse in. So, yeah. So that's quite decent coverage. So you can go after work to fill it in that couple of hours where they're still open. But I generally don't. I go during the day because I find it easier to do.
It's like mine mainly sticks to kind of, I think it's something like 8 or 6. I think there are 2 or 3 days a week where it does do until 8 p.m. and then I think they're open on a Saturday morning, if I remember correctly. But again, that still means that if I've got something minor and I'm trying to work it around my work schedule, as a general rule, I'm going to push it back as far as it can, because if it's not serious enough for me to not go to work, it takes too much time out of my working day. But by doing that, potentially, something might come to the point where either I need more serious medical attention, or at least I need more serious time off work. There is a genuine argument towards having kind of more general GP cover outside of office hours for people who have commutes or who do not work in the town where they live, because you have to register with a doctor in the town where you live, unless the rules have changed and nobody's told me.
No, the rules haven't changed.
So, you know, if you work in a different town, I mean, if you've got a long commute, you probably still want to register at home. It's like Robin works in London, doesn't live in London. You've lived in a few different places whilst I've known you, but it's never been in London. So if you've got a doctor near home, if you're not well enough to go to work, it's still trivial for you to get to the doctor.
Yep.
I live in Woking, and my previous job was in Guildford. If I'd been able to register to a doctor in Guildford, I probably would have been to the doctor for minor things more often, but then if I was ill enough to not go to work, it was still easy enough for me to get there because it was like half an hour's drive. But that half an hour's drive was enough to make it really, really interfere with the work schedule, because even if I could get the earliest or the latest, it would still make me, you know, it would still take time out of work, and there's no way in hell I could do it over lunch. Whereas if I could get something in my town of work, I could maybe do it with just taking an extra half an hour away from my working day, or the next hour to an hour and a half. So, you know, that...
I tend to work from home one day a week, so I tend to make my doctor's appointment on that one day a week. So it will take an hour out of my day that I'm working from home, but I'll fit that around my work, and my worker are happy with me doing that because they understand that I have medical conditions and that I need to go to the doctors to, you know, check up on meds, to get my blood test taken, to, you know, complain at them because XYZ is happening and whatever. But they'd rather I actually go to the doctor than to, you know, go to work and be ill.
Whereas I don't have as complex a medical history, and also I work in IT support, and it's very, very difficult to, like, physically look at someone's laptop if you're not physically in the office. So I don't have the luxury of being able to work from home.
Yeah, I do have a very specific job that you just, there's stuff I can do from home, so I can still do elements of my job. There's some elements I can't do from home. For example, part of my job is to open the post. And that post that's coming to the whole organisation. So, you know, it's not addressed to anyone, it's just addressed to the organisation. My job is actually to open that post.
But also, worst case scenario, that's a job that can, at a pinch, be done by anybody. Whereas, say, whipping out attacking a laptop with a screwdriver, knowing which bits to pull out, what tests to run, what bits to change, and how to do a rebuild of Windows, is not something, you know, you can't basically pull someone from reception or someone from senior non-IT management team to do that, whereas anybody who's got two functional hands can open the mail. At a pinch.
At a pinch, because you have to allow for confidentiality and things like that. So someone else within my team would open the post. It wouldn't be just a case of saying to the receptionist, oh, can you open it? Because there is an element of confidentiality that you have to adhere to.
So, you know, getting, I guess, you know, back on point, I think personally the biggest problem is it's the funding. They need to, I guess, rethink the way the NHS funding is done to make it work better, because they need additional staffing. Simple as that. You know, they need to have it so that, you know, so that there are more members of staff. Hell, they need more beds. They need to be opening places, not shutting them. They need to be having increased staff. They need to, you know, have increased non-emergency care so that people don't progress to the point where they need emergency care. There needs to be more community care, mental health issues. Mental health funding needs a bit of an overhaul.
Mental health funding really needs an overhaul. It's been underfunded for quite a few years. Quite a lot of places have been closed. Quite a lot of services and beds have been closed. And it's got to a point where, in order to find a ward that has a space, some people have to go across country rather than just go to their local hospital.
Or to be put onto a non-psychiatric ward, which is not always ideal depending on the circumstance.
Yeah. But basically, there are not enough beds because beds have been reduced so much due to funding issues. And so we're finding there's times where there are literally no beds in the country. I'm not saying, you know, just go cross country, you know, a few hours drive away, which some people are having to do, but there are sometimes I've heard when people have been in crisis and they're literally being told there are no beds in the country. We've looked everywhere.
Yeah, and also, I mean, I think there needs to be some more specialist care. Obviously, you know, mental health is an issue close to the both of us, but, you know, there are various other health issues that are close to the both of us, and loads of other health issues. And I think one of the problems is that as so many specialist things start to get squeezed out, things progress to a point where they're going to, you know, they're becoming general emergencies. You know, if people with specific needs aren't being met at a general level, things go belly up.
Yeah.
You know, because people, you know, people who maybe needed some sort of, you know, some sort of fairly routine operation, if a routine operation gets delayed enough, something could, you know, then cause, you know, critical organ failure or whatever, and then suddenly they're an A&E patient, whereas they might not have needed anywhere near that level of attention if they'd been able to have a routine op done earlier. Or, you know, if someone is in, you know, mental health crisis, if the capacity was there to deal with people before they reached a crisis state, A&E wouldn't be as full of people who, you know, kind of tried to take their own lives. But I think in part, and we've both seen this, a lot of the time is if you're not classed as being at risk, there just isn't the capacity for you to be seen yet.
Yeah, if you're not seen as being in crisis or seen as being urgent or severe enough, then they just don't have the capacity or the compunction to see you. You know, it's like you ask for an appointment with a psych, but unless you're actually in crisis or in a state of being in need of urgent attention, then that appointment can be a few months down the line, and there can be a waiting list for it, which can sometimes be a year.
The best way to get, and I'm not saying it, in fact, I'm definitely not saying this should be the case, this should not be the case, but at the moment, sometimes it seems like the best way to get you know, decent psychiatric care if you are, you know, you know, if you are really in need of that, is basically to be on suicide watch. And that should not be the case. You know, the whole point when you're, you know, because wherever you are, I mean, you know, I guess on the mental health scale, as a general rule, I tend to be a little bit more on the stable side of things, and you tend to be a little bit more on the unstable side of things.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
But one thing where we are the same is both of us, ideally, would rather be able to put the brakes on before things basically go completely pear-shaped.
Yeah. I mean, in recovery, they teach you to recognise your risk, recognise your triggers, recognise the signs that things are starting to go wrong, and to supposedly put the brakes on. Unfortunately, there's no actual support to do that. You can't just go, oh, by the way, I'm going to go talk to my psych or my counsellor or whatever, because unless you're in, you know, current treatment, they don't see you until you're in crisis. So you can't put the brakes on. You have to literally get to crisis point, and then they will say, oh yeah, by the way.
And then that feeds into the whole kind of cliche of a suicide attempt being a cry for help. Mm. And regardless of whether or not it is, all I will say is it shouldn't be. But sometimes it seems like it's the only way someone will get listened to. But again, that's not the fault of the person in crisis. That's the fault of a healthcare system that can't deal with it. It's like, you know, it's underfunded, and that's just one part. You know, that's just one part of healthcare. You know, that's just the mental health side of things. You know, other places don't necessarily seem to be that much better. And yeah, you know, in a way, like I said, the problem isn't purely with Jeremy Hunt. The problem just is that the NHS itself needs better support. And okay, yes, better, you know, better resourcing and better direction would obviously be the ideal. But to be honest, given the choice between the two, the funding's more important. Because with the right amount of funding, even Jeremy Hunt's going to be able to get some of it right. Because, like I said, I do think that some of the things he's trying to accomplish come from good ideas. He's just trying to implement them in an incredibly bad way. But the bad implementation isn't because he's crap at his job. The bad implementation is because he ain't got a big pot of money to deal with, and he's basically trying to do more with less. But if you've got to do more with less, you're never going to get it right. Ever.
Mm.
But the simple fact is that for various reasons, the NHS has to be able to do more. I mean, you know, it's almost like slightly the dark side of medical progress is that people are living longer and people are living through more. Now, that's a great thing, but it means that conditions that decades ago would have been fatal or would have left you with a much shorter lifespan, these days just mean that you can live for longer, but with more dedicated care. But what that means is that the NHS needs to be equipped to deal with it. Because what's the point of stopping people dying from relatively trivial conditions if we can't keep them alive if they've got the relatively trivial conditions without putting the entire system to strain? But that shouldn't mean that we should go, oh well, you've got a condition that means that a couple of hundred years ago you would have been dead at 50, so we're not going to bother. No, it needs to be funded. And
the support of the social care as well. The social care as well as the NHS is underfunded, and so the social care needs to be backed up and supported as well as the NHS being backed up and supported, because basically what people are currently doing is they're bed blocking because there's no social care to take them to be able to support them when they go back to their own homes. so the NHS won't actually release them from the bed because there's no actual support for them once they go home. So they're bed blocking. And the social care situation is such that people are being seen for 15-minute appointments because there's no funding or structure or not enough people in place for them to be seen by longer appointments. And how can you take care of someone in 15 minutes?
Not very well at all. That's enough time to get someone sat down, give them a cup of tea, ask them how they're doing, and they just open their mouth to get started.
Yeah, basically. So how can you do the, you know, helping them wash and clean, helping them take their medicine, helping them eat their meals, making sure they're not dehydrated, and, you know, as well as doing the general conversation, how are you, and, oh, you're a friend, so we'll have a proper conversation here. You can't do that in 15 minutes.
No. And, you know, it's just, the entire system is
a bit tipped up.
It's stretched thin and it's under-resourced. And like I said, I think that gets to the heart of the problem. Like I said, unfortunately, that just means it needs to be better funded. Now, one of the other things is, obviously, public funds have to come from somewhere, and, you know, to put stuff into the NHS, it has to, you know, ultimately come out of something like taxes. And then you get the whole tricky situation of how do you persuade people to pay for things that they don't necessarily think they need? Because if someone is, you know, if someone has private healthcare, or if someone has a perfectly clean bill of health, why do they want to be seen to be paying into a system that they never need? And I think one of the things that probably needs to be stressed is that better healthcare benefits everybody, and not just benefits society in an altruistic way. No, I mean, if the people around you are healthier, your life, your personal life or professional life is better because your colleagues aren't going off sick at short notice, but that's the kind of thing. Even if you don't have a condition, if you know that the people around you are more supported by society, that means that you're not dropped in it when they drop with a bad medical condition or something like that. Because at the moment, you know, if someone's routine op gets cancelled, or someone reaches crisis point and tries to end their life or whatever, that can quite easily be a completely healthy person's family member, boss, co-worker, could be the one member of staff who does a particular task in the office. You know, it's all well and good if the main person who opens the mail or the main person who cleans the toilets goes off sick, but if the main person who maintains your server infrastructure, you know, goes off on leave for 3 months, you might have a few problems in the meantime, or at least you're going to be scrabbling around a whole lot faster to try to get somebody in. And it's like everybody benefits personally if society is healthier.
Yeah.
You know, because how annoying is it, and I don't mean annoyed at the person, but annoyed at the situation, how annoying is it when someone does go off sick for a couple of weeks? And I've been the person who's been off sick for a couple of weeks in the past.
That meeting, because they're no longer going to be in it, and I have to make it for when they're going to be back. Don't try and fit in there. Yeah.
And, you know,
I've had to bump a lot of meetings because people have gone sick.
Yeah, and, you know, if the healthcare was better, like I said, society benefits, but not just in an altruistic way. It's a simple fact is that the more healthy people there are, everybody benefits, because even the healthiest person in the world can be impacted by somebody else getting ill. So if all you care about isn't so much, oh, well, how does, you know, what do I get out of the NHS, what you get out of the NHS is your co-workers, your, you know, the people, at your kid's school, the blokes who deliver the post, the people who answer the phones at the support companies you use, they're all healthy as well. And suddenly your life gets better because the people you rely on aren't dropping sick.
I mean, there was a survey done, I don't know who by, but there was a survey done of people asking, you know, would you be willing to pay more tax for the NHS, or would you be able to pay more, would you be willing to pay, you know, when they were talking about paying to see your GP, would you be willing to pay to see your GP, and they were asking all these sorts of questions. The majority of people answered that they would be happy to pay more tax in order to fund the NHS. A lot of people were against paying to see GP for obvious reasons, but because that makes it much more elitist. But I believe the majority of the people were saying, yeah, we'll pay more tax, you know, if it enables the NHS to better fund it. Although I think the country's infrastructure is in such a way that we're putting money into places where it's not necessarily being used to its best advantage, rather than putting it into the NHS, and the money needs to be refiltered into different areas, including the NHS and social care.
But again, so much is dependent on the workforce and other people in society that funding the NHS, well, you know, if it's kind of a choice between, well, does it go here or there? Well, the benefit to having a healthier population is a general benefit. So although there is always someone that loses out, it's like that's one where I think if a decision had to be made, it's never an easy decision, but it's more likely, you know, to put it in that direction. But yeah, you know, an awful lot of stuff needs to be working out
better. The UK gives more money in international aid than any other country in the world. We donate more than any other country in the world. And basically, my view is, some of that money can be filtered back to the NHS because it's needed. Because there's a limit to the amount of actual aid that can be given internationally. And that doesn't just go to the governments in that country who squander it.
Yeah, it can go to the government in our country that yeah, I'm a cynical git, okay?
Yes. But I'm thinking that some of that money could be refiltered into the NHS where it's needed. Because it currently is needed.
And I mean, there are,
and it's not saying close the entire of the international budget. What it's saying is reduce the international budget to a more reasonable level in line with what other countries are giving, and put that excess, that extra amount, into the NHS and social care, and, you know, build that foundation from there.
One thing that you said, that there was a survey about, you know, would people be willing to pay, you know, to see a GP. Now, I think general, you know, the idea of generally charging for all appointments wouldn't work. But one thing that, I was just thinking, one thing that could possibly help a little bit, or at least put small amounts of money in, would be, you know, the ability to kind of, for the cost of a prescription, and you'll see why I'll say that in a moment, but for the cost of a prescription, be able to get a higher priority
appointment.
The reason I say a cost of prescription is it's the kind of thing that people pay anyway, but also there are already people who are exempt from prescription charges because of personal circumstances or complex medical histories or whatever. So if it was...
Yeah, I don't pay prescription because I have conditions. So.
Whereas I do pay prescriptions, but they're, you know, what, 7 or 8 quid or something like that. And if it was a case of, well, you know, for no money at all, I can get an appointment with the GP in 2 or 3 weeks' time, or by paying the, you know, by paying the cost of lunch at Starbucks, I can see the GP before the end of the week. Yeah, I can manage that. But like I said, if it was done the same way as prescriptions were, the people who already have the, you know, the exemptions, who are most likely to be in need, they won't have that. You know, they won't have that problem. You know, they would be able to automatically... I mean, it might have a bit of an admin overhead, which itself would potentially have a cost, but it would be one way of doing things to make it more fair, you know, because at least it would be, you know, the only people who have to pay are the people who already have to pay a token amount towards their medical expenses, and the people who are already exempt from charges would be exempt from charges or would be able to charge back or, you know, claim back or whatever, and it would maybe be a way of being able to kind of get, I mean, and it wouldn't entirely be elitist, simply because some people wouldn't have to pay who already don't need to pay, and they're the ones who are most in need anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But the ones who aren't the most in need but have a little bit of spare money. And again, this is what goes into the whole thing about society benefits and then everybody benefits. If someone who's got a little bit of spare money can afford to, say, get an appointment this week instead of in 3 weeks' time, suddenly they're not ill during a really, really important time and impacting multiple people. Because remember, one person going off sick doesn't just mean that one person's not there. That's likely to screw over their team.
Yeah.
And their clients. So, you know, a little bit of, if you're in a position to pay, you can at least be seen a little bit faster. But it literally, if it was something like, you know, if there were a small amount of kind of same week things. Because the other thing is, if you try to open up some kind of priority slots for same week appointments, then if on the day they're not filled, the surgery, the GP surgery has more ad hoc, oh crap, someone's got a problem today appointment. And again, it means someone who needs relatively urgent attention can be seen slightly quicker, and that might stop something bad from escalating.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, it's all possible things. Would I, you know, ideally, do I want to have to pay to see a doctor? No, I like the fact that I can see a doctor without having to pay. But if I could, like I said, if I could pay basically the cost of a coffee shop lunch to see someone the same week, there are times when I would deem that appropriate. And there are other times when I go, you know what, I'm not doing that badly. I can either wait to see someone in 2 or 3 weeks' time, or I will try to get an on-the-day appointment and wait however long it takes on a day that I can't get into the office. But it would maybe be a way of, you know, of slightly increasing income into the NHS, but without overly fleecing people. And even if it was only done as a short-term measure, I mean, okay, there's always the problem with the short-term measures that end up not being short-term. But if something like that was put into place, or any sort of charging potential was put into place, it's the kind of thing that I would want it to be sort of, when it was written into law, it was written in, this will expire on such and such a date, and something similar cannot be implemented for such and such a period afterwards. So making sure that it's a short-term solution, it's not seen as a stealth way of making people pay for medical attention forever after, but maybe a way of trying to get the NHS through a crisis. But there has to be various different types of thinking going on. But again, it has to be done on all sides. And the problem is, it's like, you know, the people, you know, the people in government seem to not want to pay too much towards healthcare, and the people who don't like politicians just basically don't, you know, don't want the current politicians to be making any decisions and think just changing the regime will make everything magically better. No, because you get a whole load of change, which is not ever the most smoothest situation. And people who are perfectly healthy don't see why they should have to pay for people who aren't. But, you know, put it all together and kind of go, okay, at least in the short term, we have a problem that impacts everybody. Because like I said, Mr. I'm always healthy, what about his mates at work who aren't? And would his job be easier if his colleagues were in more in the office more? Yes.
Yep.
So you pay for the NHS, you're making your life ultimately easier. Just not directly and not in ways that you'll always see, but you'll be funding a behind the scenes situation that could well be helping. But yeah, I mean, to boil it right down, this whole thing is a lot bigger than Jeremy Hunt must go. And like I said, I think that although he is a part of the problem, he's a symptom,
not a root cause. The entirety of the problem.
He's not a root cause, he's a symptom. And getting rid of him, just basically, that's bandaging another symptom. And it doesn't change, below the surface, the fact that there needs to be a significant influx of cash to the NHS and maybe a bit of a rethinking of how some of the funding works so that those who are most in need can be seen more efficiently. Because at the moment, it seems that those most in need are the ones who are least likely to get the medical attention.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least urgent medical attention, and that's just not right. Well, we've rambled on for quite a while. So, with that, see ya.